Okay, so we have been in our, and I think I remember from last time, I'm not allowed to move, so I have to stay right here because of all kinds of stuff. So if you see me start to move, if somebody yell out, hey, stay there, okay, because I have a hard time standing still. Okay, so this morning, or in the, over the last few weeks, we've been talking about being hungry for the Spirit. It started with a week-long renewal service that we had here in the evenings where we were really inviting the Holy Spirit to come and visit with us. And that was actually brought out of the Sunday before we started that week where the Holy Spirit moved in our service and really touched a lot of people. We saw folks healed. We saw people being prayed for. We saw things being broken. And we just had a hunger for the Spirit. And Pastor Paul took that and turned it into a week-long event that they had. And then after that into, I think we're on like 8 weeks of messages around the Holy Spirit being filled and being changed and embracing. And we talked about spiritual gifts last week, and we want to continue right along with that. And today I'm going to be talking about decisions. Okay, decisions. Decisions plague us all the time. They don't have to plague us, but for the most part they do. Because it's never the decision between something that is blatantly right and something that is blatantly wrong that catches us off guard. It's that moment where, you know, this one's good, this one's good. Where do we choose? Which one do we choose? Where do we go? How do we know where to move? And a funny thing happened to me this week, and I won't say funny, it was kind of frustrating for me, is that if you heard me speak before, I'm always scared when I'm asked to preach. The reason why I'm scared when I'm asked to preach is because once I have a topic or someone gives me the topic that I'm going to speak on, I know that's what God's going to deal with me with. Okay? So that means that however much time I have to prepare for a message, God's going to be dealing with me in this place that I'm going to be speaking on. So when Pastor Paul spoke to me a few weeks ago and he said, hey, I want you to preach while I'm away getting my dad. We talked about what he wanted me to speak on. And I had an idea of something that I had been working on in my own work. And Pastor Paul was like, yeah, it's good, but, you know, kind of have this, and talked about decisions and wisdom. And that just messed me up. Because I knew that I was then going to have to examine some of the decisions that are in my world. And I had made a decision about a month ago, something that I was going to do. And I'm not going to get into the specifics, but what I'll say is that yesterday, while I was talking to my dad, that decision jumped right in my face. And he said, you know, I've noticed something different about you, the way you've been acting over the last month. And I'm really concerned because it's not who you are. And you have to be ready when God speaks to you. You have to be ready when God speaks to you. Sometimes we hear a parent, or we hear a friend, or we hear a coworker, maybe a boss, and they give us a piece of information, and we don't like it. And so we turn our back on it, and we move on, and we don't realize that God is speaking to us. God is speaking to us all the time. And I had to really examine what he had said, because my initial reaction to it was, and I got angry, and then so I'm talking back to him, and I'm very short, and he's like, well, don't get short with me, I'm just telling you what I see. And then we talked later on, and I had, you know, kind of come to understanding on that, and I thought I was doing the right thing. I thought this change was the right change. I thought this was going to fix things. And come to find out, it wasn't. It was making things worse. For me, it was a good choice because it made things easier for me. But in the end, it didn't really work out. And everybody that I've talked to has noticed it. And they might not know that I was asking them about if they noticed it, but they let me know that they noticed it. So as I was preparing for this message, I got called into, I like poetry. And I ran across this poem. I didn't really run across it. It jumped into my mind as soon as I started preparing. And it's by Robert Frost. And it says, two roads diverged in the yellow wood. And sorry I could not travel both and be one traveler. Long I stood and looked down one as far as I could to where it bent in the undergrowth. Then took the other as just as fair. And having perhaps the better claim because it was grassy and wanted wear. Though as for that, the passing there had warned them really about the same. And I'm stopping there. That's the first half. Because that last part there, they're really about the same. The choice that I had made, it was really about the same for me. Okay, because I was making a decision for myself. Okay? The decision was the same. And I said, okay, well, if they're the same, then I can pick one over the other. It doesn't really make a difference. Because it's me. I'm making a decision for myself. And as I began to examine that decision over the last few weeks and having it climax yesterday, I realized one very important thing. That in my discussions with myself about this decision, I never turned to God to ask him if it was the right one. And our flagship scripture that we've been talking about during this message, which is taken from James chapter 4, verse 8, it says, draw near to God and he will draw near to us. I didn't do that. I'm the guy who comes up here and stands before the people and talks about, you know, this is, you know, thus saith the Lord. Okay, now you know I don't say that. But thus saith the Lord. And yet, we've been hearing this particular scripture, and it's not there because I didn't give it to the guys. We've been hearing this particular scripture for the last few weeks. And yet, thank you. So we've been hearing this scripture for the last few weeks. And it never came to me. In all of my thoughts and all of my planning and all of my decision making, I never drew near to God. And that's always a mistake. So as we talk about decisions today, I wonder, are you talking to God about the decisions that you make? Are you really drawing into the wisdom that the Holy Spirit brings? And that's how we tie it all together, because as last week we talked about spiritual gifts. We went down a list of being gifted in the Spirit and what it means, and we talked about some of the gifts. For those of you who have been through our 201 class, we do quizzes and all kinds of stuff around spiritual gifts and trying to figure out our personality types. But you know what? You got to pray and ask God. You got to seek God on that. Nobody can tell you what your gift is. Nobody can tell you who you are. Only God knows who you are. We don't even know who we are. But God can open your eyes and he can plant wisdom right in you. But a lot of times we don't even look for the wisdom. Sometimes we don't even know that we can find wisdom. And that's what Job wondered. And he wondered about this very thing in chapter 28, verse 12. He said, and this is from the message, he said, but where, oh where, will they find wisdom? Where does insight hide? Mortals, they don't have a clue. They haven't the slightest idea where to look. Earth's depths, the depths of the earth, it says it's not here. The ocean's deep echoes, I've never heard of it. Because when we search for wisdom, we go to the library, we go to the bookstore, we talk to mentors, we go on retreats and we wander through the woods and we say we're going to get quiet. We get in the car and we take a drive. But where in that are you actually looking for wisdom? Where in that are you seeking after God and drawing in near to him? Because that's the mistake that I made in all of this, is that I knew what to do. I knew that I needed to make this change. I knew I needed to let everybody know that I was upset. I knew I didn't need to hide anything. I knew I needed to share everything. And I knew it because it's right. And it was right for me. But when I drew near to God and I asked him and I was looking at this and all these notes and all the scripture references and all the stuff that I had, and I was in the Bible, but I wasn't really in the Bible. Have you ever been there? Have you ever made that mistake where you're in the Word? You've picked up your Bible and I put it down there. You picked it up and you open it and you're looking through it and you're like, I'm going to find the answer to my problem right here. But you're not really looking to God. And you come across a scripture that says something that kind of addresses what you're saying, and you just jump on it and you stand on it and you say, I'm going to do it because it says it here in the Word. But you didn't look around it. You just found one line. You didn't look to see what God's intent was in that. And then you make a decision that wrecks everything. Have you ever been there? I know I have. I've been there for the last 2 weeks. I've been there for the last month. I've been there for most of my life. As I began to pray and ask God, even as I began going into ministry, I was still just opening the Bible and looking for the, you know, saying, okay, this week I'm going to preach on this. And then I can get in my Bible and flip through and look for the word I'm looking for. Or I can go online. Man, they make it easy tools, search engines. You can put in, I want to find how many times the word immediately is used in the Bible. And then, you know, you go and you start looking for something and you just jump right in on it. And you never seek God for the answer. But God said, you can't do it on your own. We took communion this morning because God knew that we couldn't do it on our own. He knew that when we were left to our own devices, sometimes we could do good things. It's possible. From the world's perspective, there are lots of good people. There are lots of folks out there in this world that would claim to be good. Oh, I give to this. I take a hold of that. I do this. I do that. But are they really good? Who knows? Only God does. But God made a very interesting point in the very beginning of the book. In the beginning of the book, you had Adam and Eve, and they were there in the garden. And in that garden, there were two trees. And this is where I'm going to ask you guys to yell out. One tree was the tree of? Well, we got them both. So one was the tree of life. The other tree was the knowledge of? Note that, good and evil. Not the tree of evil. Not the tree of wrong decisions. Not the tree of mistakes. The tree of good and evil. And then there was the tree of life. Where did they go? God put a prohibition on them, and he said to Adam, you cannot eat of this tree. And Adam said, okay, great. I will not eat of this tree. Then his wife came, and Adam, being Adam, and I'm inferring here, okay, so please make sure that you read your Bible, okay, because it doesn't necessarily say this, but I'm just thinking as a husband, okay? Now, when the serpent came to Eve, the serpent said to Eve, what? Okay, Eve said, hey, God said that I can't eat or touch this tree. Where did she get that touch from? Any idea? My opinion, Crofton's opinion, she got it from Adam. Because Adam didn't just want to say, well, God said, don't eat of the tree. Adam wanted to make sure you stay as far away from that thing as you can. Don't eat it, don't touch it. He probably said, don't look at it. And so Eve walked over to it and said to the serpent, God said, don't eat and don't touch, for then you will surely die. And the serpent said, you sure about that? And that was all the opening that he needed, was when we add. Men, I'm talking to you. I'm talking to everyone, because we should never add. We should never add our own inference in to the word, okay? I got this thing here, and as always, God he's very consistent. If you haven't realized it yet, God will always do the same thing to you over and over again. Okay? He never deviates because I am no longer on here. Okay? God said, don't open yourself up to mistakes in your decisions by adding yourself in, even into the word. Draw near to God. That's the only focus. That's the only scripture that we need to focus on during this message. That's the only scripture we need to focus on or keep our minds on as we are going through our life, is draw near to God. When we focus on God, things line up. When we turn ourselves to the left and we turn ourselves to the right, that's when we start to sink. Didn't Peter learn that lesson? He learned that lesson. Think about it. Here they are. They're in a boat. Jesus is walking on the water. Right? So this is where you guys respond back. Because this is going to be a very different message this morning. I want you guys to really be engaged in it. This isn't a moment for people to like fall asleep. Okay? Because I want to open your eyes to some things this morning. Peter was there on the boat, along with everyone else. And they saw a thing on the water. Now they knew that nothing can walk across the water. So they of course assumed it was what? A ghost. That was the first, was a ghost. Okay? Then Jesus said, it is I. And Peter said, Master, tell me that I can come out there on the water. Jesus said, come on. Peter stepped out onto the water and he began to walk on water. He began to experience the miraculous. He began to do something that everybody else felt was impossible. And then what happened? The wind and the rain. And he saw the negative. He saw the thing that said, you're going to die. And then what? He started focusing on that. Then he started to sink. He started to go into the water. It started to come up his body. Imagine that. Okay, so you're standing there and you're standing firm. Then all of a sudden the water starts to rush up. And you know that you're in very deep water because you just stepped out of a boat. And now you're afraid. Now, mind you, Peter's a fisherman. So shouldn't he know how to swim? But he was scared because he was looking at the thing that was going on the left, the distractions. He started to sink and he got afraid because he was no longer seeing Jesus. He was seeing his mess and the stuff, the additions, the things we take on, the things that get in the way of what's important. And as he began to sink, he knew what to do. He said, Master, save me. And Jesus was right there. Draw near to God and God will draw near to you. He'll draw near to you in the decisions that you make. He'll draw near to you in even in the mistakes that you make. He'll come and save you out of your mess. Say, I'm already moving. You got to remember that. He'll save you even in your mistakes. He'll pull you up. Do you believe that? Do you believe that God will lift you out of the mess? Do you believe that God will pick you up where you've fallen? Do you believe he's strong enough to get through what's going on in your world? Are you sure? In your daily walk, are you sure? I want everybody to examine it because I know where I'm at. Sometimes I am like so full of the Spirit and full of faith in God that I think I can fly. And sometimes I don't even want to get out of the bed. And the thing is, it's the same God. If I would just stay focused on him all the time, I could at least walk. And I keep my mind focused on him, I could run. Can you do that? Even in your finances, even in your relationships, whether you're married or not married, whether you got a significant other or not, in your relationship with your friends, are you drawing near to God in your relationship with your friends? And what you do every day, are you drawing near to God? Think about it. Are you? I'm not asking you to answer. You keep that one. That's for you. Okay? Are you drawing near to God? Are you really focused on him? When you make a decision, are you drawing near to God? We've got some major decisions coming up. Everybody's got major decisions. Who in here doesn't have major decision coming up? Anyone? See, no hands. Everybody's got a major decision going on. So that means that this very week, right now, right as you get ready to leave, you have an opportunity to see if you're going to put this into practice. Okay? That's what I want you to do. When we get up here to preach, there's knowledge that's being passed on, there are things being said, but at the end of the message, at the end of the time you're in church, at the end of this time that you're with God, what are you going to do with it? And I want to talk to you about some decisions that that we have coming up. I'm going to talk to one specifically that is on my heart all the time. It's on my heart all the time, and I don't know why it is, but it always has been, even when I was, you know, growing up in my house. Okay, we've got an election coming up. And I know people are not always jazzed about talking about elections. And I'm not up here to talk to you about who you should vote for, who you shouldn't vote for, because of course we're not supposed to do that. But even if we were, I'm not going to do that. Because that decision is between you and it's between you and God. You've got to make that decision. But I want you to think about a few things as you prepare. We just got done with some conventions. Some people watched them. They say they were some of the most watched conventions ever. So maybe you saw some stuff that you liked. Maybe you saw some stuff that you didn't. But what I really want you to do is I want you to pour in and pull into God in your decision for this country. Your decisions that you're going to make for the United States. Your decisions that you're going to make for your voting choice. Now, not everybody in here is old enough to vote. Some people are, some people aren't. And that's okay. We have rules. So please don't try and run in there and vote when you're too young because they will stop you. Okay? I work with a guy who's an election judge. He says they are very serious about that. Okay? So, two things I want you to remember to do as you go forward in this. The first one is to draw near to God so he can draw near to you. And I want you to really get to know your candidates. I want you to really get to know the people who are running. Yes, you might not be able to call them up on the phone and have an hour-long conversation and ask all the questions, but you can look at what they've done. You can see who they are versus what they say. You can see who they are versus what the media portrays them as. Because as a news, I call myself a news hole because I'm always reading news. And I'm always looking and reading and doing stuff, especially from an election standpoint. This is like my time right now. For all the guys that are here that are all hooked on football and are all ready for that, for me, this is like football time. Because there is all kinds of stuff I can go out and look at. Find out who these people are. Really learn who they are versus the noise. Because there's a lot of noise out there as well. And there's an enemy out there who really doesn't want us to be a successful country. And we want to be a successful country, correct? I hope so. I hope you want us to be a successful country. And when I talk about noise, I want to share something with you that's actually on topic, which comes from 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 11. God's Spirit spoke to the prophet, and he said, "Go stand on a mountain at attention before God, and God will pass by." A hurricane wind ripped through the mountains and shattered the rocks before God. But God wasn't to be found in the wind. After the wind, an earthquake. But God wasn't in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, fire. But God wasn't in the fire. And after the fire, a gentle and quiet whisper. That's where God was. God was in the quiet. He was there in the silence. And let me tell you, there's a lot of noise out there. I was listening to a pastor this week, and he talked about how we fill our life with noise. We go and we get in our cars, and the first thing we do is we turn on the radio. We get up in the morning, the first thing we do is we turn on the TV. We get home from something, whether it's work or school, and we turn the TV on. We turn on a video game, or we get on the internet. We fill our lives with noise to the point where there's this ever-present buzz going on. And it's almost like a muffling sound. Have you ever been, like, had one of those things where they play, like, the white noise, and then you can't hear anything? Can't hear anything at all? That's what we do in our world. And that's what the world does to us. Because the world knows that if we really take hold of what God is saying, we really take hold of drawing near to God, if we really take hold of who God is, there's nothing that we can't do. I say it, and I've already said it once today. We're going to win this battle. Okay? You turn to the back of the book. We're going to win this battle no matter what. But the question is, or the question I have for you, is how well are you going to reach your end? Because you're going to win. Yes, granted, you're going to win. But would you rather be walking in victory now? Would you? Would you rather walk with power now? Would you rather walk in boldness now? Would you rather get past the mess that you made of your life? We might not see it as a mess. Might not be a mess. Or our perceptions, it might not be a mess. But there is a mess that we left behind. Okay? I can look back over my life and I know there was a mess back there. And in some cases, there's a mess right here. But when I draw near to God, and I let the Spirit of God move in my life, and I embrace him for who he is, this stuff starts to clear. And when I realize that God said that all that stuff that's behind you, don't even worry about it, because I've taken care of that. I know I can walk forward in victory. So even though I spent 2 weeks agonizing over this, and I spent 2 weeks in my own mess, it took one word from God that only took a few minutes to clear it up in my mind. But you know what? It's not always going to be easy walk. Like he said in the video for fireproof, it said, marriage is not fireproof. You're going to get burned sometimes. Life is not fireproof. You're going to get burned sometimes. We are not perfect. This thing is like all over the place. We are not perfect. So we're going to make mistakes. But when we draw near to God and we focus on Him, we can get past the mess. We can pick ourselves up. We can walk on. Are you ready to do that this morning? I want to do something different because we've got some time. I want everybody to stand. If you came here with someone this morning, I want you to pair up with that person. If you cannot be with that person that you came with, or if you didn't come with anyone, turn to the person next to you. Some people have the option. They can turn to the left or the right. Some people might not be able to. Is there anyone here who does not have a partner to pray with? Okay. Miss Sheila, would you come up? There we go. Now we got a partner. Anybody else? Anybody that does not have a partner to pray with? I notice I have an odd number here in the front. Boss lady, can you come here, please? And that would be Olivia Kaiser, our wonderful worship leader. Okay. So now we have an even number here, so now everybody can pray. And I want everybody to turn to your partner, and we're going to pray. I'm going to start by praying, and once I'm done praying, I want you guys to pray for each other. I want you to pray that the decisions that you make are founded on drawing near to God. I want you to pray that you would open your eyes and see who God is and only focus on Him, because He'll direct your path. He'll order your steps. Okay? Are we ready? Father, we thank You this morning for this time with You. We thank You, God, that You opened our eyes this morning, that You revealed something to the people. God, I thank You that You came to me even in the midst of my mess, and You spoke a word of encouragement to me. And not just a word of encouragement, God, but a word of rebuke, a word of reminder that I was making a mistake. And I thank You for it. I thank You, God, that You've come to this place to stand with these people. And God, I ask that as they pray, that they would all draw near to You. Because God, we know that once they do that, You'll draw near to them. And not because You're far away from them, God, but because they may not be focused on You. God, I thank You that You're going to bless them. You're going to keep them. You're going to work in them and through them. In Jesus' name, amen. Please continue to pray. But as I close, I did want to finish the poem from Robert Frost. And it says, "And both that morning equally lay in leaves no step had trodden black. Oh, I marked the first for another day. Yet knowing how ways lead on to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sigh somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference." And that led me, when I got to the end of that poem, it led me to a scripture from Matthew chapter 7, verse 14. And this is my wife's scripture. It says, "Because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there could be that find it." Do you have life this morning? We took communion this morning. Do you have life this morning? Good. But I never want to be up here. I never want to give a message. I never want to talk about God and not offer a prayer up for those who may not know God. And I want to just take a moment. Everybody just close your eyes. I'm going to pray one more time, and then we're going to have the worship team back up here. But I just want to give anyone who has not ever embraced Christ, who has not accepted Him as their Lord and Savior, I want to give them an opportunity to know the freedom that you have. And so that means that for those folks who are here, for those folks who are watching us on TV, for those folks who are listening to us over the internet or on a CD somewhere that you might have handed them, I want to give them the opportunity to bring Jesus into their heart. So God, we thank You this morning. And God, we remind ourselves that You came to us when we were sinners, God. And God, we recognize that that's who we are. We are sinners. And God, that without Your grace, without Your love, without Your mercy, we could not do it. We would be lost. So God, be with us as our Lord and Savior. Be with me, God, as my Lord and Savior. Be with me in my heart. Be a part of my daily walk. Be a part of my decisions. Be a part of my time. Be a part of my family. Be a part of my relationships. Clean me up, God, so that I can know true fellowship with you. Embrace me and love me. In Jesus' name, amen.